Hello, everyone, and welcome back to That Paradox Computing. So today we're doing something a little different. I've been working on a project with Dizzy Aaron. He's created an amazing thing. It's an armor management system that looks just fantastic. So before watching this video, you should probably see the full thing in action. So see the link on your screen, go click that. Watch the video, give Dizzy a like and a sub because yeah, his what he's made is great and he's got some excellent stuff on his channel. So go check that out. And then if you're interested, come on back and I will show you exactly how it is that I made this with Computercraft. So yes, go check that out now. Okay. Welcome back. So as you can see, it's a fantastic system. It looks great. I'm just going to be covering the Computercraft script. Now, because this may have a bunch of people who are not familiar with my channel coming to check out, I'm going to be going through the code in depth. So for the more experienced Lua users, this may be a little tedious, for which I apologize. But yeah, let's see how it works. So basically, as you can see, we can enter a label. So if we click on a blank cell, it says enter label in the computer. So we're going to the computer now, and we can see it's asking us. So we'll say like diamond, yeah, armor. We'll say diamond, bam, and then we can see bam, three. So what we can do now is if we click on diamond armor, what's going to happen is out the back, we've got a redstone output. And as you can see, it's a fairly weak redstone output, only going for three blocks. Well, if we set one here, it's like, say, seven, and we just say whatever, we'll just call it something. And there, okay. So if we click this one now that we've set it, there's going to be a redstone output of seven blocks. That's because, the factory manager in the video, in Dizzy's video that's connected to the computer, what it does is it reads redstone signal strength to determine which armor it's going to use, or which armor it's going to put on the user. As you see, if we hit 15, that's going to put a redstone strength of 15 out the back of the computer, and that's how the factory manager knows to activate the little transporter thing or the player inventory block that you stand on that equips and unequips armor. If you hit 15, that's how it knows to unequip the armor from the user. So yeah, hope that all makes sense. We can also delete the labels we've written, and now they're gone. Cool. All right, so let's get into how this code works. Now, it's not a very long script, but there's some concepts which might take a little while to explain. So get comfortable, and I hope this all makes sense. So I'm going to do this as if I'm talking to people who are unfamiliar with Computercraft, because there may be a few people coming over from Dizzy's channel, yeah, who aren't familiar with it. So here we go. I'm going to try and do this quickly, but also have it make sense, which can be hard. So mon equals peripheral.find. This is basically just how we find the monitor. We're going to be referencing mon a few times in the script. You can see here, like we're referencing mon. So this is how it knows it's looking for the monitor. And we're just doing a peripheral.find, which just means it's going to find the monitor attached to the computer, which means the monitor can be on any side, as long as the monitor is touching the computer somewhere, or it can be connected via cabled modems as well. Yeah, it's just going to find the monitor. Nice. So we've got a function. Now, function is basically something we're going to refer to later in the script. So this isn't all going to happen straight away. The code runs like chronologically, but we are going to be referencing this draw background function later on in the script. And you'll see, it'll make sense. Like you'll see, we go, oh, okay, this is when it wants to do that. Just so for now, the code kind of ignores it, but it will reference back to it later. So what we're doing is we're using this mon that we've defined here, mon.set the background color, colors.black. So it's setting the background color, the color behind the text to black. So we're setting it black and then we're clearing the screen. So when we clear the screen, it'll clear the screen completely black. And really all that's left of that once it's all done is this black area down the bottom here. Now we're doing, yeah, so we've done mon.clear. Then we're going to set the text color to colors.black. And we're doing, so this is, these are the commands to set the background color. This is to set the text color. So we're doing x, y equals mon.getSize. Now what that's doing is it's getting how many characters can fit on the screen. So, if we look across, we're going like, the size of this monitor would be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And if you counted all the cells for the characters all the way across the screen, you would get X. Then if you counted down, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, you can see here we've actually got numbers, so 15, 16, 17, 18, 19. So Y will be equal to 19. So we're getting how many characters across, how many characters down on the screen. So X is going to be across, Y is going to be down. So we've now got some variables to establish the size of our monitor. Now, what we're doing here is a for loop. Now, what a for loop does is it's going to count through, in this case, 1 to 15. It's going to perform everything from here to where it ends here. It's going to do this 15 times. Now, you might notice 15 is also the number we've got written down here. So what this is actually doing is it's just drawing these rows. It's drawing these rows. So it's drawing these gray and blue rows across the screen. So that's what this little bit here in this for loop is doing. So this YC, and it counts through the 1 to 15 in Y. So if it's doing it for the first time, YC is going to equal 1. If it's doing it, if it's doing it its second time, YC is going to equal 2. And, you know, when it gets to the last time it does it, which is 15, as you can see here, YC will equal 15. So we're checking here if, basically what this is we're going to check the number of YC, and we're just determining if it's odd or even. This is just a really easy way to see if something is odd or if it's even. So if it's odd, we're going to write up light blue. So as you can see, the top one is odd, light blue. Gray, two is even, so it's writing it up in gray. So if it's odd, then do light blue. Else, which will basically be if it's not odd, so if it's even, it's going to set the background color to light gray. Then we're doing this another little for loop inside of this for loop to track the X coordinate, which is writing across the screen. And we're going to say, basically, we're just doing this for as many cells as there are in as there is X. So we're doing from 1, which will be the basically the cursor position of 1, to X, which is the last one. When we remember how we did that X, Y equals mon dot get size. So this is that X here. This is that X there. We're getting that number, how far across the screen goes. And basically we're going to write up, so when it gets to this, it's going to go mon that set the cursor position XC, which is being, again, like YC was tracking how far we are through this loop. This one's tracking how far we are through this, this one's tracking how far we are through this little loop just here. So basically what it does is it runs through Y. So let's just say it's going through the first time. It runs through here and it gets our, YC is going to be 1 and XC is going to be 1. And when it goes to set the cursor position, it's going to be 1, 1. But then, it'll run through this loop, you know, one time. So it'll go through to here. Then this is going to perform the number of times there are X. So that would be like about 30 times because the screen's probably, about 30 characters across. It'll do this 30 times, and each time it's going to set our X position, and it's going to count up. Y will always be 1 because we've still only just run this loop to here. And then once this completes, it's going to go around, and then YC will equal 2, and that means it's going to go down the line onto the Y coordinate 2, and then we'll perform this little loop a bunch of like 30 times for each X, and it's got to keep updating the X position across the screen, writing up our background colors. So look, I hope that made sense. Then also it's writing up the little colon. It's also going to be writing up YC colon, which means it sets the cursor position back to here, and it writes up, so YC, as you can see here, is counting from 1 to 15. Well, So it's going to basically be writing up what number we are on the y coordinate. So it's going to be writing up 1, 2. That's how we're getting these numbers here. This is how we're getting this 1 through 15 colon here. And you can see that just here, mon dot right yc. So we set the cursor position to 1 on the x-axis, which is the far left-hand side of the monitor. And we're typing up yc. Nice. All right, guys. Well, that was... yeah, I hope that made sense. That was probably not the easiest way to get started in the video. Okay, here we've got our second function, the input page. Now, there's some bits of this code I've still got to tidy up. This level is redundant, so just ignore that. There's just a couple of things which are a little bit redundant. I'm going to go through and clean up this code a bit later on. But to be honest, it's all working, so it doesn't matter. So what we've got is we're just clearing the monitor. What is the input page? The input page was when we clicked on one of these blank cells and it asked us to put in a label. You remember that? So yeah, we wrote in diamond. So for like your diamond armor or whatever armor. So yeah, so when you click on a blank cell, it brings up an input page. It asks you to click on the computer. And in the computer, we wrote in, diamond armor, hit enter, and then that became, came up on the screen. This is how that all works. So we're clearing the monitor. We're setting the background colors to light gray. We're setting the cursor position. So that's literally, we've just seen this, the cursor position stuff before. We're setting it at half of X, which is like, the middle of the screen, and like half of Y, which is also the middle of the screen. We've also got minus a bit, so this is actually centered, so it sets the cursor. So if this was up on the screen in the middle of the screen, we're taking a few characters off just so this looks centered. And then now we're clearing term.clear, so not a mon.clear, we're doing a term.clear, which means we're actually clearing the terminal on the computer. So when you click on the computer, any text or anything that's there gets wiped away. And then on the computer, the terminal, we're getting the size of the terminal on the computer, and we're setting the cursor position to basically the middle of the screen like we did up on the monitor just before, and we're writing up a big blank space for the user, where the user is going to be typing in whatever they want. So whatever they want to put the label as, so diamond armor, gem armor, whatever. And then we're doing a label equals read. So we're doing a read. Now what a read is it lets you get whatever the user has typed in. So once a user types diamond armor or whatever, it's going to be assigned to this variable of label. So this is how we're going to, this is how the computer stores what the user has put in. Then we're basically just setting the terminal background color to black, and we're clearing the terminal. So the terminal will just go back to blank and it will be black. Nice. excuse me. Now we're actually doing something else. We're going to write a file on the computer. And to do this, basically, what is a file on the computer? Sorry, let's start off. Let's look at ls, sorry, not ks, ls. And that shows us the files which are currently on the computer. Now startup is this program that's doing all this. Listen is another program that I wrote. And so that's what we're going to create using the code, using the script. We're going to actually create, oops, what am I doing? There we go. So we're actually going to write a file, and it's going to be called, well, there's this parameter 3. Now, ignore that for now. Basically, what the files are going to be called is corresponding to each of these numbers on the left here. So the file will be called 1 for anything. So the file 1 will store whatever label we're going to write up here, so like diamond armor. So the file will literally contain, the file is literally going to contain whatever the user wrote up in here, and the file is going to be called whatever number the user clicked on along the screen. So to do that, we're creating a file. Now this parameter 3, I'll explain what parameter 3 is a little later on when we see it, but it's basically 1, 2, 3, 4, up to 14, whichever one the user has clicked on. So we're opening the file in write mode, because we're going to write to the file, and then we're going to file.write the variable label, which was the read we got off the user, so whatever the user typed in, then we're going to close the file. Nice, so that is how the input page is written up. Now this function drawButtons is really just the text that gets written up on the screen, so it's this ready to it's re it's that text. It's also the it's, I don't think it's the unequip armor, but it's also the labels that the users have put in. So if a file actually exists with a label in it, it's going to be that text as well. So that's how we're writing that up. There's also you saw me delete some labels before. You click on the little X's on the right-hand side of the screen. It's going to be drawing up those little crosses as well to delete. Yeah, nice. So this literally just draws stuff up on the screen. Now it's not a particularly amazing piece of code, but let's just go through it. We're getting the monitor size again, so just getting, how far down on the X coordinate, how far on the right coordinate. You probably don't need to do this as much as I do. I like to do it just because people change screen sizes occasionally. Like, they'll delete a they'll break blocks on it. And I like to try and have my programs adjust for that as much as possible. So we're doing a get size again. And here we're doing another for loop. So this time we're counting from 1 to 14, which means it's going to be performing this function, sorry, this loop from there to where it ends there. It's going to be doing this 14 times. And as you can probably guess, it's the 1 through 14 here. So we check it. We're going to be doing this for each one of these lines. We don't want to do it for 15 because 15 is to unequip the armor, right? So we're doing it for those 14 lines, basically. And what it's doing is when it goes to write up this stuff on the screen, it's going to check if a file exists for that number. So I is going to be keeping track of what stage in our loop we're at. So if we've done it once, I is going to be 1. If we've done it twice, I is going to be 2. And we're checking if the file exists. So, and I, ignore this two string thing here. It's a whole, we're not going to get into integers and characters and strings and stuff. Just the main thing to look at here is I. So this is going to be, so if the file exists, so the first time it's going to be 1. If a file has exists on the computer called 1, then so that's that would have been what the user inputted for on line 1. If the user has created a label for this line, then we're basically going to open up that file. And we're going to read everything that's in it and assign it to a variable called label. And then we're going to close the file. So I hope this is making sense. So we're basically here, we're just checking if the user has created a label there. And if so, we're going to open up the file that contains the label. And then we're going to assign that to the variable label, closing the file. Then we're setting the cursor position. Basically, just in the middle of the screen, we're reading how long the label is and dividing it by 2 and minusing that from x divided by 2. So basically, this is just to try and put it somewhere in the middle of the screen. Just, I know that's a big thing. String dot, yeah, just ignore that. We're just trying to set the cursor position near the middle of the screen, and then we're just kind of going to the left a bit just so whatever the user has typed in is in the middle of the screen. Then we're doing this divide by 2. This, remember that getting odd and even for setting the background color? We're just doing the exact same thing. So when the user when this gets written up on the screen, it's the same color as these lines are, as you can see here on the left. And then we're setting the text color. Then we're writing the label. So we're writing whatever we read from the file. So we're basically, yeah, just writing up, diamond armor, power armor, whatever the user has called it. And then we're just doing, oh, look, we're also just drawing up these X's. So if a file exists, it's going to write up that little X on the over here on the far right-hand side so we can delete it. Nice. Cool. Then we're setting background colors again, and we're just writing this unequip armor. So you can see here, we're setting the position, the cursor position right there to write unequip armor. Easy. Now, this is another if statement here saying if unequip. So that's the end of that loop. So that's the 14 times it's going to perform all that. And yeah, we've got another if down here. So we're checking if unequip, and we're actually looking for if unequip equals true or false. Now, we haven't seen where unequip gets defined, where this variable is created. So I'll point it out when we get down to it. That's basically, unequip is basically if the user has clicked unequip armor or if it's clicked something else. It's how the program knows, If it needs to write this little bit of text up down here, ready to unequip the armor, please stand on the transporter. So that's when, you know, you want to take the armor you're wearing off. So yeah, that's just down there. And you'll see later, but it's basically if the users click this, a variable called unequip gets created and it'll be true. But if the user clicks anywhere else on the screen, like to activate the other redstone signals, then actually equip some armor, then it's going to equal false and that's going to disappear. So what we're looking for is if unequipped, so if that's true, then we're just writing up all this stuff down there. And we've gone through enough writing up stuff. You don't need to see any more of that. Cool. So now we're actually at the main like bit of the text. Everything else we've been looking at is text, the script. Everything else we've been reading up here has been a function. So this is where we're actually going to refer to it. So basically the way the script runs is it wraps that monitor as we saw at the top, then it basically skips all of that stuff and comes down here to this while true do. Now what a while loop, this is a while loop, what while true do it do does is it basically just runs infinitely. It just keeps running until it gets told to stop or the computer turns off. It's just going to keep running. So and it's going to do different things depending on the user's input, which we'll see here. So we're going to start getting into when the user actually touches the screen here. So we're getting that monitor size again, probably unnecessarily, but whatever. We're clearing the monitor. Then we're using those functions to draw the background, which draws up all the colors on the background. Then draw the buttons. So it knows it's going to draw up any labels. It's going to draw up all of this stuff. If unequip is equal to true, it's going to draw up that stuff. And then we're looking for an event. Now events, a very basic way of explaining what an event is it's anything that happens. Anything that happens is an event. Clicking, this, me clicking here and saying the cursor position is a click event. Typing on the keyboard is a click event. Touching the monitor is an event, and we're looking for specifically a monitor touch event. That's the event we're actually looking for the code to recognize. So then we've got, so this is the os.pull event, monitor underscore touch. So that's us looking for someone touching the screen. Now when someone touches the screen, a bunch of information is going to get spat out, and we're assigning it to these different variables. So we've got the first variable that gets spat out by touching the monitor, or by any event, in fact, is this event parameter. That's going to be that monitor underscore touch that you saw at the end of this line. The next event is actually the side that the monitor's on. So parameter one, in this case, is going to equal left. Then we've got parameter two and parameter three. Now, parameter two is where the user has touched the screen on the X coordinate, where the user's touched going along this way, going left to right. So if you clicked here in the top left-hand corner, parameter two there is gonna equal one. So parameter two would be one. And if I clicked right there in the top right left-hand corner, parameter three would also be one. But if I clicked like down here on the Y, down one on the Y coordinate, then parameter three is going to be two. Parameter one would be one still because we're on the far left-hand side on the X coordinate. But parameter three would be two because we've clicked down here. So it's kind of imagine an Excel spreadsheet and how you keep track of your cells in there, exactly like that. Cool. So this is how we're keeping track of, this is how we know where the user has clicked. So now we're going to start doing some if statements to check where has the user clicked. So we're going to say if parameter 2, so that's x running across the screen, is less than x minus 2. So x minus 2 would be like there basically. So if the user's clicked anywhere from there down to 1, anywhere less than x minus 2, which is going to be all of that space, then we know that we've fulfilled the first clause of our little if comparison here. And so we're doing if it's less than x minus 2 and parameter 3, which is on the y coordinate, is less than 15. So we know just looking, because we've got these numbers here, we can tell where 15 is. So that's there. So it's going to be anything less than 15. So we now know by looking just at that if statement, that we're looking for a touch anywhere from here up and about there across. So what's in that space that you can click on? Well, that's going to be our labels, where we've set our labels up. So what we're going to check here is, basically, it's going to do if FS exists. So we're checking if a file, there's a file on the computer that exists, that basically equals parameter 3. Just ignore the 2 string there. That equals parameter 3, which is the Y coordinate. And what would that be? One of these numbers, basically. Because that's, as you can see, these are, you know, all the numbers on the Y coordinate. So if we've got a file, so if the users click, bam, there. We can know just by looking here that that's 8. And it's going to be looking for if a file exists called 8. Because remember when we created, when we got the user to input their label, it wrote a file to store that label in. And yeah, so it called, you know, whatever level, whatever cell the user had clicked on. So yeah, nice. So basically, it's going to check if there's a file corresponding to that number. Now, if there is, then it's going to set the analog output. And this is basically where we get our redstone output coming from the back of the computer. RS stands for redstone dot set analog output back. So the back, so set the redstone on the back of the computer. And we've also got to number parameter 3. So parameter 3 is where the user has clicked on the screen. So that's if it basically clicks 4, parameter 3 is the Y coordinate, so that's 4. So we're going to set the redstone strength to 4. So that's it. Where you get 1, 2, 3, 4. The redstone will come out that far to 4. In this case, in the case of what this program's designed for, the factory manager would then get 4 from the redstone strength and then go on to, you know, give you the armor that's assigned to 4. So that's how that works. And we've also got this unequip equals false here. So that would mean once unequip equals false, we saw that earlier on in the draw buttons thing. It was what wrote up this little bit of script down here. Next time the computer ran, next time the script ran through our while true do loop here, it would go, oh, okay, unequip's false, don't write up this stuff. Nice. So, else, now, so we've got if the file exists, but if there isn't a file there, so if there is no file called 4 or 5, whatever, what it's going to do is get up that input page, which we went through all the code for before, where it says, okay, writes up on the screen, okay, enter a label in the computer, you go to your computer, you type it all in, blah, blah, blah. So that's when it knows how to do the input page. Nice. Cool. So let's say, though, the user doesn't click in that space there. Let's say, instead, the user has clicked on and parameter 3 has just returned 15. So we're looking at if parameter 3 is equal to 15. We've just gotten, so it hasn't met that condition. It's instead, it's meeting 15. That means what we can see here, 15. The user has clicked, parameter 3, remember, being our Y coordinate. The user has clicked on somewhere right along here, which means we want to the user wants to unequip their armor. So in that case, it's fairly simple. We just set the redstone signal to 15 out the back. Yeah, so that maximum strength, which is what we've got on at the moment, maximum strength signal of 15 coming out the back of the computer. We're also going to say unequip equals true. So once this, once it's done that, it'll loop through, and when it goes to draw the buttons, that function up the top, it will know, oh, unequip is true. We've got to write up this bit down here. Ready to unequip the armor, place stem on the transporter. Nice. Now we've got an else. So if whatever our event returns, it doesn't meet that statement. So it's not anywhere in that kind of area there on the buttons. It's not number 15. The user's clicked somewhere else in the on the screen. What it's going to do is delete parameter 3. Now, remember how there's the X's at the edge of each line? Basically, we've ruled out the user clicking anywhere else. We know if the user hasn't clicked here or here, then we know the user's clicking here. And what we're going to do is delete whatever file is the same as the number on parameter 3. Parameter 3, again, being the Y coordinate. So parameter 3, let's say it returns on the y coordinate returns 8, right? But we've clicked over here on one of the x's, and it knows parameter 3 is 8. We've got to delete file number 8. Nice. And that's it, guys. Look, that was a slog. That was 100 lines of code and explaining some pretty big concepts. So look, that to the complete lure beginners, you've probably bailed out of boredom by now. I imagine most people probably have, but for those of you who stuck around, well done, congratulations. Thank you so much for watching, guys. Remember, do go check out Dizzy's channel. Give him a like, give him a sub. There's some good stuff up there. He's a very dedicated YouTuber. He puts a lot of stuff up, and he has some great ideas and has made some cool things. So yeah, guys, well, look, thank you for watching. I hope you found this enjoyable. I hope you have learned something. And yeah, guys, stick around for some more videos. They're going to be coming soon, and I will talk to you later. Cheers for watching. Bye.